Looks like another party celebrating Walt Disney World's 20th birthday. Hello, I'm Michael Eisner, head of the Walt Disney Company. We're supposed to meet the Disney gang here to watch tonight's special. This must be their party. It's hard to believe that it's been 20 years since the Magic Kingdom was officially dedicated to Walt Disney World in Florida. It gives us tremendous pride to think about the hundreds of millions of people who have visited and enjoyed the fun at Disney World. Our challenge for the future is to try to make the next 20 years even better. Hi, guys.
Happy birthday, Michael.
Mickey, it's not my birthday. It's the birthday of Walt Disney World.
Sure.
We bought you a present, Michael.
Really, I think you guys are confused.
Oh, no.
Put it on.
Try it on. Anything for Goofy.
Looks great, Michael. Here's a piece of birthday cake.
No, Mickey, you don't get it. But I will try the cake. It's not my birthday.
What?
You know, Walt Disney World, 20 years old this year.
It's not your birthday?
No. What? I thought it was his birthday.
Michael, the cake, please.
Really?
Yeah.
Not bad.
Can I have the cake back? Now the robe. The robe. Goofy,
the robe.
Get the robe.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on, give it here.
We'll be right back, Michael. We're going to take the robe back before the store closes.
Sorry,
come on, gang.
Guys.
We're using your car, okay?
I thought you said it was his birthday.
Well, Minnie, now I can have my piece of cake. I can eat it, too.
Coming up next, it's a special celebration in the place where dreams come true. Join host John Lithgow as he brings you a special look at Walt Disney World. From the visions that started the magic, to the incredible attractions that make Walt Disney World the happiest place on earth, to the imagination that will create more joy for generations to come. See Walt Disney World like never before. So join host John Lithgow for Walt Disney World, past, present, and future, next.
A little while ago, I was invited by the people at Disney to attend a special celebration at Walt Disney World. I'd never been there before, so naturally, I jumped at the chance. Now, I'm sure you've heard a lot about Walt Disney World. Maybe you've even been there. But here's your chance to experience it from a whole new perspective. Hi! So come on along with me and discover why Walt Disney World has become the number one vacation spot on Earth.
Welcome to Walt Disney World, past, present, and future, with your host, John Lithgow.
You know, this is really a treat for me. Like everybody else, I grew up with images of Disney on television, in the movies, everywhere. In a way, Disney has helped me stay a kid all my life. Now, I'm an actor, but on this trip, the only role I'm playing is myself. Wide-eyed tourist, doting dad, middle-aged kid who just can't seem to grow up. And being an overgrown kid, I've never quite lost my curiosity. Now, when I came here, sure, I wanted to ride the rides and see the sights, but also, I wanted to know what went into creating this place that I've heard so much about. And what I've learned is, there's a reason Walt Disney World is the number one vacation destination on Earth, and the reason is very simple. They planned it that way. And what they've created here is like no other place I've ever seen. Walt Disney called it his greatest dream. And considering how many dreams Disney brought to life, that was saying something. From the very beginning, this place was designed to be one of a kind. What the Walt Disney Company has created is more than a collection of theme parks. It's an entire themed world. A world that blends imagination and storytelling, builds it with painstaking planning and detailed construction, and then showcases it in whimsical architecture and art direction. The result is what some people have called the art form of the 20th century. The Walt Disney World story starts where all great stories do, in the beginning. This one began 3,000 miles west of here in an orange grove in California. Where the fact is, there never would have been a Walt Disney World if there hadn't been a Disneyland. So let's go back to the beginning of the story. Once upon a time, in 1954. As a child, growing up in Yellow Springs, Ohio, I remember watching television every Sunday night and seeing Disneyland being built. All of us kids dreamed of someday going there. What an amazing place. Every component was designed, or storyboarded, as we say in Hollywood, like a Disney movie.
Walt Disney gathered together architects, engineers, and movie storytellers and named them Imagineers. Together, they planned Disneyland to be the first themed entertainment park. Every land had a theme. Main Street USA, Adventureland, Tomorrowland, Fantasyland, and Frontierland. Every detail in every land was designed and art directed to match its theme. Like magic, from start to finish, Disneyland was built in just 1 year. I'll never forget it. Opening day was like the premiere of a Disney movie, and I was there, right in front of my TV. With 29 cameras rolling, the television broadcast on that July 17th was, at the time, the biggest live production in history.
And look who's riding in the various cars. Frank Sinatra! Hello, Franco. Who's driving? Frankie?
My son, yes.
Don't hit this man. Oh! Look who hit who. Sammy Davis Jr. Hello, Sammy.
In 1955, the role I'm playing today as your host was taken by Art Linkletter. I don't know why they didn't ask me. I was available. I guess they just didn't want a 10-year-old host.
And there the boat is christened, and it starts on its daily trips up and down the rivers of the world. Of America, that is.
One of Linkletter's co-hosts was a movie actor, pretty well known in those days, a fellow named Ronald Reagan.
With the first visitors to travel through the gates of time and into our very historic past.
People got the message. Disneyland was one of a kind. The detail and planning were evident everywhere. Even the employees were part of the story. Walt called them cast members because in his mind, everyone working at Disneyland was part of the show. And their wardrobe was part of the theme. Excuse me.
May I help you?
Disneyland was something people had never seen before, and see it they did. Between 1955 and 1963, over 35 million people visited there. During the same 8 years, the population of Orange County, California tripled. Disneyland's 90 acres were soon hemmed in on all sides by hotels and restaurants that kept Walt Disney from acting on the ideas running rampant through his mind. Disneyland was a huge success, but Walt had even bigger plans. And no one was more hip to the emerging technologies of the information age than Walt and his Imagineers.
In 1960, Walt Disney was the commander of the 8th largest submarine fleet in the world.
Walt Disney was an American treasure. In many ways, he personified the American spirit. His renown was such that presidents and kings came calling on him. But no matter how grand his guests, he was always just plain Walt. When the King of Belgium visited Disneyland, he asked Walt why the Matterhorn Mountain had holes in it. Walt replied, because it's a Swiss mountain. That was Walt Disney.
In the next few years, Disney tapped his Imagineer's talent for turning technology into entertainment, threw in a touch of his own magic, and dreamed up Walt Disney World, the grandest plan he had ever had. In 1964, Walt set in motion two major projects that would make his new dream come true. First, he created four innovative attractions for the New York World's Fair. Then, later that year, very quietly, Walt began buying land. Lots of land. Enough for 300 Disneylands in another Orange County, this one in Florida. On November 15th, 1965, Walt announced his company's plans for Florida.
Well, I'm very excited about it because I've been storing these things up over the years.
Walt wouldn't live to see his greatest dream unfold. But before he died in December of 1966, he made a film outlining his grand design.
Here in Florida, we have something special we never enjoyed at Disneyland, a blessing of size. There's enough land here to hold all the ideas and plans we could possibly imagine.
According to this scale, I am 6 miles tall. Now that's 12 miles from here up to here, and the whole area encompasses 27,400 acres. That is 43 square miles, twice the size of the island of Manhattan.
This was the legacy that Walt Disney left his Imagineers. A vast, empty field on which they could build their dreams. Just think of the awesome challenge. Like an artist hired to paint his masterpiece. Imagine yourself facing that huge, empty canvas. Where do you start? Well, the Imagineers started with the thing that people wanted most, another Disneyland, only bigger and more advanced. The big difference was that in Florida, they had all the room they needed. They could create and control an entire community, an entire world around this magic kingdom.
From the start, Walt Disney World would be a completely master-planned environment. Everything would be designed by Disney. Roads, waterways, buses, boats, telephones, utilities, everything down to the buttons on the cast members' costumes would have the Disney touch. The people who brought it to life, from the conceptual stage through engineering, art direction, and show design, were the Imagineers. Like Disneyland, there would be an overall theme for each individual area, only this time on a more global scale. Construction began in 1967. Roy Disney postponed his retirement after Walt's death in order to carry on with the company's plans for the Florida property. Roy was Walt's older brother and in many ways his guardian angel. Roy balanced out Walt's extravagant ideas with the common sense of a Kansas City banker, which is what he was before Walt sold him on another line of work. In fact, it was Roy's idea to name the Florida property after his kid brother. It was always planned to be called Disney World. Roy insisted that it be called Walt Disney World. From 1967 until the park's 1971 opening, Roy was the guy. Sitting in on creative meetings and tending to the business side as well, he was the driving force. The Magic Kingdom opened on October 1st, 1971. More than a mere 76 trombones, this 1,076-piece marching band, directed by music man composer Meredith Willson, led a parade down Main Street, USA, as thousands and thousands of guests stormed the gates. Once again, Walt Disney's Imagineers had surpassed everyone's expectations.
The two tallest mountains in the state of Florida are both at Walt Disney World, Big Thunder Mountain and Space Mountain.
Thanks for the ride. You step inside the Magic Kingdom and you're in another world, Disney's world. Walt used to say that he wanted no contradictions in his company's designs. On Main Street, USA, his designers recreated the kind of small town USA that Walt himself grew up in. No contradictions. Everything you see reinforces that turn of the century feeling. You know how a good story sweeps you along with its descriptions of the way things look, sound, and smell? Well, the Magic Kingdom is like that. Everything you experience is designed to create an illusion that makes you forget for a while the outside world. A good story also draws you in, makes you want to see what's around the bend, whether the prince will get the girl, and what kind of magic is about to happen at Cinderella Castle.
One of my first impressions of the Magic Kingdom is its size. Compared to Disneyland, everything is bigger. The streets and shops are full-sized, waterways weave through the park, and towering at the center is Cinderella Castle. Over 18 stories high, it's more than twice as tall as Disneyland's Sleeping Beauty Castle. From the hub in front of the castle, the various lands fan out in different directions. One route leads you into the future. Another takes you back into the American West. Another into exotic adventures. And if that's not enough, you can journey into Neverland.
With the Magic Kingdom, the Imagineers had created a great opening scene for Walt Disney World. There's a thousand stories here. A journey of practically unlimited twists and turns. It would be a prelude for everything yet to come.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you.
more than 33,000 cast members in the Walt Disney World family.
In Walt Disney World, where you stay can be as exciting as what you do, because the hotels are part of the fun. For my first trip here, I said I wanted to stay at a typical Disney hotel.
Well, I quickly found out that Disney hotels are anything but typical.
My hotel, the Polynesian Resort, is like all the hotels in Walt Disney World. It has a theme of its own. For the Polynesian Resort, the Disney folks conjured up outrigger canoes, a rainforest, luaus, and more. And everything fits the theme. Restaurants, signs, decor, and costumes worn by the cast members. Yes, the play's the thing all over Walt Disney World. The transportation system here is amazing. It includes the largest private bus system in the world, and that's the real world, not just Walt Disney World. Plus Disney design boats and trams, and of course, that essential component of modern urban planning, the monorail. Walt Disney World is as complex as any major city, or small county for that matter. Disney Imagineers designed every component of the property with all the care and detailed planning that it took to create Cinderella Castle. It has its own fire and police department, its own utilities and recycling center, its own medical facility, and even its own fiber optic telephone network. The fact is that Walt Disney World has become a textbook example of modern urban planning and design. I have to remind myself that in 1965, this was all empty. Every square mile that has been developed was environmentally planned. 7,500 acres are set aside as a conservation area, and 50% of the acreage will remain in its natural landscaping.
Walt Disney World's telephone company was the first to use a fiber optic cable system for its regular service, and the first in Florida to establish a 911 emergency number.
The success of the Magic Kingdom made possible the company's next big project, a theme park that was destined to become the largest privately financed construction project in history. Back in the 60s, the Disney Imagineers took to calling it Waltopia, but Walt himself had another name for it.
We call it Epcot, spelled E-P-C-O-T, Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow. Epcot will take its cue from the new ideas and new technologies that are now emerging from the creative centers of American industry. It will be a community of tomorrow that will never be completed, but will always be introducing and testing and demonstrating new materials and new systems.
Walt always had an interest in technology. From his first cartoons, through the many innovations in his animated classics, to his three-dimensional forms of entertainment, his appreciation of new ideas never waned.
Now this contraption here might look like something from outer space, but it's actually a control harness for programming the actions and gestures of our audio animatronic figures. This electronically controlled method of programming can give us a wide range of movements. A broad gesture to the wink of an eye. That's it. Thank you.
A generation of artists, filmmakers, engineers, designers, and craftsmen had been shaped by Walt Disney's vision. Epcot would be their vision, too.
I believe we can build a community here that more people will talk about and come to look at than any other area in the world. I'm sure this experimental prototype community of tomorrow can influence the future of city living for generations to come. An exciting challenge, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for everyone who participates.
Epcot Center, as the Imagineers called it, required an expanded vision beyond just entertainment. So they recruited some of the world's best thinkers and designers in areas as diverse as urban planning, marine biology, and agriculture, and said to them, "So, what's next?" The answer was an eye-opener for everyone. Where the Magic Kingdom was built on a foundation of youthful fun, Epcot Center would be a community of ideas. The Imagineers wanted it to be entertaining, sure, but more important, they wanted it to be thought-provoking. Epcot Center would be a world community, a center of knowledge and information, and a proving ground for future technologies. For Epcot's signature structure,
the Imagineers needed an image as unique as the Magic Kingdom's castle. Something that would say, here's a place that's global in scope and futuristic in design. They made an inspired choice, Spaceship Earth. Dominating the Florida landscape, it is the world's largest geosphere. At 180 feet tall, there are 2.2 million cubic feet of space inside. And the amazing thing is that it is stable without any interior supports. Epcot Center, like everything else in Walt Disney World, tells a story. But this isn't a fairy tale, a fantasy, or a legend. This is the story of man, of our time on the planet. A story told with flashbacks to the past and flash forwards to the future. As you walk around Future World and you see the living seas, the land, Journey into Imagination, and all the others, you begin to get a sense of what the Imagineers had in mind when they built this place. To create an environment filled with excitement, surprise, and anticipation for the future. The story of man, as told at Epcot Center, is filled with inspiring twists of ingenuity, triumphant achievements, and heroic examples of human potential. The simple recurrent theme is that life is a wonderful thing, always has been, and will continue to be so in the future.
The Living Seas Coral Reef Tank is 27 feet deep, 203 feet across, and holds 6 million gallons of seawater.
The Wonders of Life exhibit is my favorite experience at Epcot Center. This high-tech attraction gives guests an entertaining, hands-on look at health and fitness.
The 100,000-square-foot pavilion is an example of Disney storytelling at its finest. Who else but Disney could turn the intricate workings of the human machine into fascinating entertainment? It took 14 years of research, conceptual designs by experts in the fields of health and nutrition, and the collaboration of Imagineers and top filmmakers to create the Wonders of Life exhibit. The resulting attraction covers the subject literally from head to toe by combining science, athletics, food, medicine, and brilliant art direction. You can experience a ton of stuff here, from a thrill ride through the human body to restaurants which feature fat-free foods. See these kids? Every single one of them is learning something, and they don't even realize it. I don't know about your school, but mine didn't have a 70-millimeter motion-controlled theater to take us on a tour of the human body. The Body Wars adventure takes place in a theater which is actually a flight simulator. You remember those great old magazine articles like, I am Joe's spleen? Well, in this ride, you meet Joe's spleen up close and personal. The emphasis here is on nutrition. Goofy About Health is a multimedia presentation starring the Goofster, Gooferino, the Goofmeister, getting healthy, eating all the right foods. The anatomical players turn health into humor, or is that the other way around? And Cranium Command takes a funny inside look at the battle between mind and body raging in your typical 12-year-old.
I'm your commanding officer, General Knowledge, and it's my job to turn you mealy-mouthed meatheads into a quack squadron of Cranium Commandos.
Since 1971, Walt Disney World horticulturists have planted 18 million flowering annuals and 884,000 trees.
How would you like to spend a year or two in Norway? Or maybe Italy is more to your liking. Me, I would take the south of France, which is what brings us to this little corner of France at Epcot Center's World Showcase. Bonjour, mes amis! Ho, ho, ho! In settings like this, all around the 40-acre World Showcase Lagoon, young people from countries all over the world meet and work together in their native settings. Ah,
bonjour, mademoiselle.
Bonjour, monsieur. Puis-je vous servir quelque chose?
Merci bien, ma petite. J'aimerais bien les escargots, s'il vous plaît, aux noisettes.
Snails? And peanut butter?
Epcot Center's World Showcase almost looks surreal. The Eiffel Tower, Japanese temples, pyramids, castles, and colonial America all on one horizon? Again, the tricks of the Imagineering trade play with your sense of time and space. Going from Norway to Mexico in 5 minutes,
too if you run. Or you step inside a dark room and suddenly all around you, China. Circle vision. 9 cameras, 9 screens, 360 degrees of view, invented by the Imagineers. There's something about visiting an ancient, very mystical country by way of a high-tech, modern-day movie theater. The first time I saw it, it gave me goosebumps. Illuminations. Every night, the nations of Epcot Center undergo a transformation, with old-world landmarks blending into a new world of sparkling lights and color, creating a spectacular laser and fireworks pageant. Using more than 700 individual fireworks and 24 coordinated computer systems, the show turns all of World Showcase into a stage. Behind the scenes, it's an incredibly intricate production, and it all adds up to a simple and transcendent moment of magic.
Epcot Center's Seven Seas Lagoon spans 185 acres. It took 3 years to excavate and is larger than all of Disneyland.
As of 1984, Walt Disney World featured the Magic Kingdom and Epcot, 3 hotels, a campground called Fort Wilderness, a nature preserve called Discovery Island, lakes, tennis courts, golf courses. Pretty impressive, right? Then the next big thing happened. Michael Eisner and his team arrived at Disney and revitalized the company that Walt built with a kid in a toy store energy and a non-stop flurry of new ideas. Eisner hired some of the world's top designers to take the resort architecture to new heights. Every addition became another element in the story, another setting for new adventures. All the new construction has a real sense of fun about it. You can see that in a place like Typhoon Lagoon. According to the Disney storytellers, a typhoon, an earthquake, and a tidal wave converged to create Mount Mayday, which is topped by the stranded shrimp boat, the Miss Tilly. The theme permeates the design. Signs are roped together, lamp posts rusted, and the 56-acre park is flooded with the after effects of a huge storm. There's nothing halfway about it. It sells the story of Mount Mayday and Miss Tilly like an actor sells his scene to the audience.
Discovery Island, a natural preserve open to guests, is home to more than 500 creatures, many of whom are endangered or injured.
A good example of environmental design at Walt Disney World is in the use of water. It's the lifeblood of the park, and while there's plenty of it available in Florida, a lot of designing and planning goes into its use. The Imagineers work within the environment rather than pushing it out of the way or depleting natural resources. Walt Disney World recycles 5 million gallons of water every day. They use it for transportation as well as irrigation. Discovery Island is a refuge for rare and endangered species of wildlife, a refuge framed and protected by 185 acres of water. When it rains 3 inches on one end of Walt Disney World and none on the other, a computerized flood control system equalizes the water level throughout the park. Disney employs a full-time staff of marine biologists who make sure all the lakes on the Disney property maintain a biological balance. For rides such as the Pirates of the Caribbean or the Land Exhibit, which transport guests on waterways, the biologists design refrigeration programs which inhibit the growth of organisms and minimize the need to use chemicals in the water. Water is also an important design element in Walt Disney World. Whether it's the moat around Cinderella Castle, leapfrog fountains, or a flash flood in Catastrophe Canyon, water helps bring the story to life. Welcome to Pleasure Island, an exotic playground especially designed for kids 18 years and older, right smack in the middle of Walt Disney World. The Disney storytellers have come up with another great tale for this place. According to their story, Pleasure Island was a port settled in the early 1900s by that legendary explorer and entrepreneur, Meriwether Adam Pleasure. The industry of this little town was refurbishing yachts for the rich and famous. Along this boardwalk were all sorts of shops dedicated to the pleasure principle of lavish and unique yacht ornamentation. Then, in the 1950s, pleasure's bustling harbor community was wiped out by Hurricane Connie. A few years ago, those intrepid Disney Imagineers uncovered this hidden treasure and restored it to its original splendor. Here on Pleasure Island, you can rock farther around the clock than anywhere else in Walt Disney World.
3, 2, 1. Every night at Pleasure Island is one big party!
And every day, here at Disney-MGM Studios, everybody gets a chance to be a star. This is a working soundstage, see? Up there are all the people going through on a tour. I'm watching them, watching me, making this TV show. Pretty neat, huh? The Disney-MGM Studios theme park opened in May of 1989. It's a film and television studio with a back lot, a New York street set, camera, props, and wardrobe departments, and huge sound stages where shows like The Mickey Mouse Club are shot. This is where you can see tomorrow's movies while they're in production. And it's also a theme park, steeped in the mythology of the silver screen.
The first thing that hits me is how many of these buildings look familiar. Like the places we're all used to seeing around Hollywood that were built in the 30s and 40s. What everybody refers to as Hollywood's golden age.
There's the Brown Derby, and over there, the old Pan Pacific Theater. Here at Disney MGM, the castle at the end of Main Street is the Chinese Theater at the end of Hollywood Boulevard. When Disney and the Imagineers created the Magic Kingdom, they transformed Disney films into three-dimensional reality. The characters and settings of Disney's most beloved stories came to life in surprising and sometimes inspiring ways. The Disney-MGM Studios takes that concept one step farther. Here, you're not just watching the action. Here, you get to be a part of it.
People aren't aware of just the danger involved.
Do like this. Oh, Jungle Boy, I searched the planet, okay?
Oh, Jungle Boy, I searched the planet and found you in the Metropolis.
Who was in this cab last week?
Who?
Errol Flynn was in this cab last week.
I don't know.
You sat right in the back seat.
You're going to break the lens with the sound reinforcement.
Oh, my goodness. It's just oh, look at this. All dirty. Yeah.
Even eating here at Disney-MGM is a themed experience. If you want to step inside the golden era of Hollywood, just book a booth at the Brown Derby. Inside, you're surrounded by Art Deco, potted palms, and caricatures of old-time stars. You can even order a Cobb salad, the meal that originated at the Brown Derby 60 years ago. Of course, my heyday was a little more recent than that.
Hey, you better go grab a table, Daddy-O.
Neato torpedo, Hepcat.
See you later, alligator.
After a while, crocodile.
Hey. You're cool, man, cool.
Welcome back to the 1950s at the 50s Primetime Cafe. Burgers, fries, and a chocolate shake. That's my scene, Dad.
Just look at this place. The attention to detail is unbelievable. I know this era. I was there. And let me tell you, everything about this place is perfect. From the attitude of the waiters, to the plastic mustard and ketchup bottles, the salt and pepper shakers, the formica tables, they've nailed it. You're right back in the golden age of television.
Elbows off that table, young man.
Gee, sorry, Mom.
Oh, you're so cute.
Gosh, I love this place. Hey, I know that little guy.
I've spent a lot of time in and around the movies, and I've worked with some very talented people. But inside this attraction, you will find, pound for pound and pencil for pencil, the most talented collection of artists in the film business, Disney animators. The way in which they transform lines drawn on a sheet of paper into the illusion of life is one of the most amazing performances I've ever seen.
Just hold still. If you'd hold still, it wouldn't hurt as much.
Well, if you hadn't have run away, this wouldn't have happened.
If you hadn't frightened me, I wouldn't have run away.
Beauty and the Beast is the 30th full-length animated feature film, created by the Walt Disney Studios.
Welcome to Hollywood with a Disney makeover. The cars are vintage, the cops are Keystone, and the attitude is classic.
Hey, Cabby!
Oh, I get it. This is the place where every guy is Tom Cruise and every woman is Marilyn Monroe. It's the Land of Oz. It's 34th Street, Rick's Cafe. If you've ever dreamed of being in the movies, this is the place.
Hey, mister, want a lift?
No, thanks. I've got a ride. Great. My grandkids can come here years from now and find my handprints. In fact, they may even find me unless I can get myself unstuck. Mickey! Mickey! I'm stuck!
Ladies and gentlemen, John Lithgow!
Mr. Lithgow, this way, please!
What you see is only the beginning. Because Walt Disney World is in a continual state of becoming, idea by idea, structure by structure, a true community held together by a wonderful way of looking at the world. Walt Disney's original mandate still holds true. The company's plans call for even more adventurous expeditions into entertainment and ideas for living. This site is in the process of turning into Sunset Boulevard.
The legendary Hollywood Theater District will feature the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. It'll drop you 13 stories straight down through the fifth dimension, right into your own episode of The Twilight Zone. Across the lot, you'll be able to take a wild trip on the Toontown Transit, a runaway bus that hurtles through the cartoon streets of Toontown. An exciting new peak is being added to Walt Disney World's mountain range. Splash Mountain will send thrill seekers on the fastest and wettest ride in the Magic Kingdom. Over at Epcot Center, the Imagineers are hard at work on a space pavilion for Future World and a new Russia pavilion for World Showcase, plus a thrilling ride through Mount Fuji at the Japan Showcase. In addition to the plans for all these new attractions, the Imagineers' drawing boards are chock full of concepts and ideas for entirely new theme parks. The Magic Kingdom, Epcot Center, and the Disney-MGM Studios are only the beginning. Friends, it looks like we ain't seen nothing yet. I'll tell you one thing, I'm coming back. More than 1 million professional entertainers have marched, sung, juggled, tumbled, and paraded at Walt Disney World in its first 20 years.
There's a lot going on down here. Every day in the Magic Kingdom, there's an all-new parade led by Grand Marshal Roger Rabbit called Surprise Celebration. Every night in the kingdom, there's an electrical extravaganza called Spectro Magic. Over at the World Showcase in Epcot Center, there's a dazzling daytime fireworks and flying spectacular called Surprise in the Skies. And Disney-MGM Studios has another fantastic fireworks show called Sorcery in the Sky. I think everybody should have the opportunity, at least once, to see the world through Disney's eyes. You'd see children laughing and grown-ups with a brand new perspective on things. You'd see a future full of promise, a past overflowing with happy memories, and all the excitement of what's happening right now. You'd see the last 20 years as only a beginning, the whole 20th century as just a prologue to the great story you're going to tell the world. After only these few days at Walt Disney World, I can see now why it's become the number one vacation spot on the globe. And with all those Imagineers backstage dreaming and designing more and more new adventures for this place, you can feel pretty confident that Walt Disney World will continue to change and evolve. Walt once said, "Somehow I can't believe there are many heights that can't be scaled by a man who knows the secret of making dreams come true." I think if he could see his name on this dazzling display of inspiration, invention, and imagineering, Walt Disney would be proud. I'm John Lithgow. Thank you for joining me on my tour of Walt Disney World, past, present, and future.